All right, guys, so where did we leave off? I think we left off with students and inspiration. So I hope you know where my notes are located and that you don't just go and sleep, but to actually read them, because I spend this, you see, I do not need the notes and I don't need the detail for myself. I do therefore hope that you actually go and read it. That's why I post, that's why I spend this time writing it. And I'm sorry it's not typed, it just typing it would have taken in the short duration longer, you understand? I mean, I just barely make it before the lecture. Typing or drawing diagrams takes me a little bit longer. And here is where we left off, the Pythagorean theorem. Let me remind you guys, very easy to prove it, which surprises me therefore that so few of you have known the proof before, and there are many proofs. Here is one. If I have a triangle of leg A, and another leg B and hypotenuse C, it's a right triangle, the square of the sum of the squares of the legs equals to the square of the hypotenuse. And here is the proof. All you do is make, you have four copies of the same triangle, right? Four copies, it's the same triangle. And then you arrange the triangles in this pattern, A and next to AB, you rotate it by 90 degrees, you see? You take this triangle, rotated by 90 degrees. And then the side that used to be A will now be B. And then on top of it, rotated again by 90 degrees, and that would be B again, right? So you have A, B, A, B, A, B. Form this pattern. If you want to maybe draw it on a, with a roller on a piece of paper, cut it out so that you can actually play with shapes. So what you have is now a square of, the big square is of side A plus B. You can see this is A plus B and A plus B. And you have a small square of side C. The area of the small square is C squared. Isn't the proof amazingly simple, enormously simple, right? I mean, it's clever, of course, to put this pattern, but once you see this, it's like you cannot be lost, I think. So C squared is the area of this small square. And A plus B squared is the area of the big square. Now, all I have to do is remove from the area of big square the four areas of the identical triangles, or four times the area of one triangle. Agreed? So this is the proof. Look at it. C squared is A plus B squared minus four. One half AB is the area of one such triangle, right? We verified that the area of this triangle is half the area of the corresponding rectangle, which is therefore B times A times one half. Everyone is with me? So subtracting it out, I am left with A squared plus B squared. Here is your proof, the simplest I know. There are many, many other proofs. Good? And then we mentioned about line segments. We spoke about the Pythagoreans and what they when they meant when they said all is number. And that's perhaps, I mean, depends on how you view it, right? It is a very, 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 very subtle idea. Do you understand, guys, that you might be very indifferent to measurement? That's another thing that I wanted to tell you. If you looked at the quantum physics book that I suggested, it's not a simple book. It's trying to present the material with the bare minimum, but it's not simple. I can explain the details that you might be missing if you are interested, okay? The theory of relativity and quantum physics are really ideas about measurement, very deep ideas about what it means to measure something. And here is what you, when you think about basic measurements, you have such kindergarten questions as, how tall are you? How long have you studied? If you are worried about your girlfriend gaining a lot of weight, you ask, how heavy are you, right? But that, of course, is not necessarily a good idea. If she's very heavy, it's not a good idea. Sorry for my bad humor, all right? How long have you studied? How much, well, as I already mentioned, let me not push my luck. How fast are you driving? And then you can ask even weirder questions. Is the future determined? Is there such a thing as cause and effect? Is time travel possible? Which is, by the way, my greatest hope, right? If I could, I would right away take a time machine and go back many years. Not too far in the past, but into the past of my glorious youth, right? По несчастью или к счастью, истина проста. Никогда не возвращайся в прежние места. Which means, fortunately or not, the truth is simple. Never do you return to places that passed. So here is the Pythagorean idea, what it means, all is number, right? Here is a line segment. And of course, anyone who is not American knows that you measure line segments in meters, centimeters, and everything like that, right? So this is a line segment measuring 14 and something centimeters. To be precise, it's 14 plus 4/10 of a centimeter. And notice that what this means, 14 centimeters plus 4/10, it means that the measurement is a fraction. You understand? It's 72 over 5. That's a fraction. That's what Pythagoreans understood measurement to mean, fraction. Good? And here is that very troubling phenomena that I mentioned last time. Is there such a thing as this length C? Okay, so is it measurable? If let's say this is what, let's say this is one. This one I think is 2 inches long. And this is another one also 2 inches long. Basically, that's my unit of measurement. Can I measure this hypotenuse in terms of this one? Is there a length that exists that matches this triangle? So then I can see that C squared equals to 1 squared plus 1 squared, which is 2. So I see that the length of this C answers to the measurement square root of 2. It's a number that when multiplied by itself gives 2. Yes? With me, guys? I'm teaching you some things that are not immediately required, but this is needed if you study analysis. Analysis is what anybody knows calculus to be when they're not in the United States. They call it analysis, or real or complex analysis. Calculus is not a common word outside of the English realm. Then here is this question. Is C a number? Is there a measurement like this? So because we're having problems finding that measurement, we claim it exists in abstract symbols. So let's say there is going to be an integer divided by another integer that will give me that measurement. You follow what I'm doing, guys? I cannot give you numbers because no numbers that I can give you will actually end up working. And I'm showing you why, right? So when you cannot find a fraction that actually matches this criteria, that when you square it, it gives you 2, you try to do it abstract. You say, will any fraction work? And this means any fraction. This is a typical fraction, yeah? Or as they say in Germany, beliebiger Bruch, which means just a random fraction. Make sense? So what do I know about it? Well, I know that I can always reduce it to simplest terms, right? I simplify it. If it were of the form 3/6, I can simplify it to 1/2, so that the greatest common divisor of numerator and denominator equals to 1. Are you with me? You understood everything I said, my friends? Sorry, I call you friends. It might be a parasitic word. I might start suddenly calling friends too frequently using that word. It's not a word that you throw around. Yes, friend. Exactly. Germans hate when you call someone friend, right? They will just look at you like surprised. If you ask somebody in Germany what time it is, like, excuse me, it is a private matter, right? They don't really share anything. So here, we square this number, m squared over n squared is 2. 2n squared, therefore, equals to m squared. I just multiply everything by n squared, which means, this symbol means not division, it means that it is a statement, 2 divides or goes evenly into m squared. You understand? So two times some number equals to m squared, which means 2 divides the square of the number. Now, it happens that, if you're interested, we can talk about it in office hours, that if 2 is a prime number, if it divides the square, it must divide the number itself. You understand? So for example, 2 divides 16. 2 must divide the square root of 16 or 4. Okay, that's what this is saying. Good? So we know that 2 divides m, which means m is equal to 2 multiplied by k. If any of it is not clear at some point and you are interested, stay after class. I promise I will explain. Okay, so we have therefore that n squared equals to, so we have that 2n squared equals to 2k squared, which is 4k squared. And if I simplify, I'm now at the situation n squared is equal to 2 times k squared, which again means that 2 divides n squared, which means that 2 divides n. But that is a contradiction because I just found that 2 divides m and 2 divides n, but their greatest common divisor was assumed to be 1. You understand? So I assume that the greatest that I reduced before I carried out this procedure, I reduced m and n so that they have no greatest common divisor greater than 1. And yet I find that they are divisible by 2, each of them. And that means that no fraction, the interpretation is that there is no fraction that will produce square root of 2. And what does it mean? It means that when you press root 2 in your calculator, and this is what you get, this is me actually pressing in the calculator and you get those digits. This is not root 2. Understand? It is not root 2, it's an imposter. If you add more digits, it will still be an imposter because no matter how many digits you add, if there are finitely many digits, it is a fraction. And a fraction cannot satisfy root 2. You see, because this is 4 over 10 plus 1 over 10 squared plus 4 over 10 cubed plus 2 over 10 to the fourth. You understand? When you add a bunch of fractions, you just get another fraction. And root 2, we just told, cannot be a fraction. And this is true about many numbers, root of 3, root of 5, root of 6, root of 7. Most numbers, when you try to take their root, there is not going to be a fraction. So that means that it's not measurable. Understand? It's, you're speaking about sizes that cannot be related one to another. It's the non-relatability or relatability of one measurement to another measurement. And again, guys, do not despise measurement. That is, this is the cornerstone of science. It is the cornerstone of relativity theory or quantum mechanics, right? It's all about the subtleties of making measurement, of observation, right? It's like something that I was reading about quantum mechanics brings you back to this question. Does a tree make a sound when it falls and there is no one to hear it? Okay? It's something like this that you feel. And it usually sounds like a silly question and you might say, sure it does, or you might say, sure it doesn't. But that is actually not trivial when it comes to those intricate things. And then of course I mentioned, why do I care? Or why do you care? I mean, I care, I suppose. Why do you care? And I remember teaching, I mentioned that in office hours, you reminded me of course, to inspired me to put it in this lecture again. It was a while ago, I was still a young instructor and I had to teach a pretty low level class. They couldn't give a damn about what I had to say. They were absolutely indifferent. There was one guy and a girl that were just making out in the corner, right? So I got very irritated. And I said this, okay, then you don't mind if I take a brick and throw it on your head, which in fact I wanted to do. So why is that related? Here is what will happen, guys. When I let go of the brick, the position of the brick in t seconds will be 16 t squared measured in feet. Okay, so let me hold the brick at a sure good distance of 5 feet over your head. I pick 5 because it's high enough to make sure that there is a nice impact, that it impresses you. Yes, so hold it 5 feet over your head and then let it go. Here is my question before you look at it. Well, what would happen? Would anything happen? And if something happens, am I to blame for it? You know, you love the word it. And here we're being very loose about the word it. Pavel, do you know about the lullaby about the wolf? You know, if you sleep on the side, a wolf will come and bite you on the side. I might have to play it for you. How are you doing? Don't worry, I will pick a very heavy brick. I will have trouble lifting, but for you, I can lift mountains. Yes, you are under it. So my question is this. I will take a brick. I will lift it 5 feet over your head and I will let go. The question is this, what will happen? And if something happens, am I to blame for it?
The brick will fall on someone's head.
That's what you're saying. The brick will fall on someone's head. In other words, Carolina, you are, well, gravity, that's nice of you, Dante. It's good that you're protecting me, right? But let's ask this. Will the brick make contact with your skull?
Unless you see it and move first.
Don't worry, I will install a device to prevent you from moving. Right? It's for the sake of experiment. It's for science. Yes? How many of you believe in science? You believe in science, guys? Right, yes or no if you believe in science. What the hell is wrong with you? Are you religious nutters? Do you know what science is? Science is when you think and pick up the facts. If when you say you believe in science, that's called an oxymoron or simply a moron, right? So when you see people with science, I believe in science, remember this thing, they are idiots, they're morons, right? What you do in science is think. You understand everything is a theory because everything can be put into doubt, right? When you say, I believe in science, it's like science is some sort of God, a new religion. All right, back to this question. Will the brick make contact with your head?
Yes.
Yes. Well, let's ask this question more precisely, mathematically. The brick will be moving, that I can show you why, but maybe later. Yes, take this formula for granted right now. It's called 16 t squared, right? So in t seconds, the brick will travel a distance of 16 t squared. And to touch your head, it will have to travel a distance of 5 feet. You understand? So 16 t squared equal to 5. You understand, my friends? Yes? 16 t squared equal to 5. So that means that t equal to root of 5/4. Now, specifically, you understand, as I mentioned, you can press in your calculator what is root of 5, but that is not root of 5. You can argue just as I did for root of 2. Root of 5 is not a finite string of digits. What you give is an approximation. So here is the problem with it, right? So first, if root of 5 does not exist, that means that there is no moment of contact of the brick with your head, which means the brick was falling. And if your skull caves in, that has nothing to do with the brick. It's just coincidentally, the skull caves in coincidentally because where the brick was fallen, right? Or maybe you're impervious. It means the brick never actually hits your head, but there is no moment of contact. You understand what I'm saying? If there is no root of 5, there is no one moment of contact. So several things can happen, of course, right? Some sort of notion of cause and effect can break. And it seems that if you do believe that root of 5 exists, then you believe in an infinite description, because I can describe root of 5 as an infinite fraction. Many things, right? Remember, e to the x is an infinite polynomial, as I described. By the way, I hope you are learning about e, right? So one of the reasons I learned it rather recently, one of the reasons that many of your applications, as good as they might be for jobs, will never be looked at, only maybe 38% of them will ever be looked at, has to do with the number E, right? It's called optimal stopping strategy. I'm not sure if I sent you a link about it. If not, I will send you one, right? You might be interested. So it has to do with, when should you stop? You have a sort of pile of information, you go through it, and at some point you wonder, do you want to go through the entire list or should you stop, okay? So that has to do with the exponential as well. Just as, by the way, much of probability, much of anything has to do with E and with trigonometry. And you would actually see something pretty impressive if you dare to look there. Now, I think I carried out the calculation. I think I already did it for your class as well, or haven't I? I haven't, yes? So here is, by the way, a very nice and simple way to calculate roots. Are you ready? So here is root of 2. What I do is I take 1 plus root of 2 minus 1. Why 1? Because 1 is the closest number to to root of 2. If I take 2, it's already bigger. So I just pick 1, and then I do something very very simple. I multiply by and divide by the conjugate. The numerator now becomes 1, denominator is 2. And the denominator is, sorry, is root of 2 plus 1. It's here, right? That's the denominator. You see it? Yep. Beautiful. So then I realized that the denominator can also be written as, I want to see here root of 2 minus 1, because if I see this box, I can carry this operation again. So what I do is, I write it as 2 plus root of 2 minus 1. Just because I can then see this blue box over here. Look at it. What I did is tautology. What is root of 2? Root of 2 is a number that when squared gives you 2. But I didn't really figure it out. But here, I wrote in this pattern. I see the same pattern again. So I can now place it like in a bubble. You see the entire thing, guys. You see this entire thing is this entire thing. And it's also a part of itself. You see what I'm saying? Again, a very important, cannot be underemphasized. Look at it, guys. You see this? It is the entire thing here. And also, it's also here. Yes? It's basically, it's a bubble containing itself. And then I can replace it by itself. So I replace this purple bubble by 1 plus, 2 plus, plus whatever there is. And then again and again and again, and I get into this fraction. We can practice it in office if you're interested in seeing that you can calculate it, right? And then look what magic is gonna happen. Let's say what we have here. Here I actually made a mistake, and even with my mistake, the answer is getting to be correct. I can explain to you what it is, right? So what does it mean? I can try, I can see what is it? It's 1 plus 1 over 2. And then a better approximation is 1 plus 1 over 2 plus this thing. You see that? I just make more of this pattern. The more of the pattern I make, I'm hoping the more like root of 2 it will appear. Now, 1 plus 1 over 2, it's 1.5. Then I make another approximation. Here I made a mistake. It's not 2 over 3 because I should multiply this by 2. It should be 2 over 5. Not 2 over 3, but 2 over 5. And then there are subsequent mistakes here. Okay. I carry out this calculation. Again, if you stay after class, I will speak more about it. And look what happens. As I just carry 9 or 10 operations, look how many digits I'm getting. You see, I'm getting the same digits as in your calculator. So you can use a very simple idea, if you have it, to calculate roots. You understand? You use this infinite process, which seems to yield, whatever you think of infinity, this seems to yield really interesting result. This philosophy is able to produce results that you can actually confirm, I suppose, with a calculator, of course, or you don't have to trust a calculator. Just take this number and square it, you understand? Multiply it by itself. And if you get something that is closer to 2, that means you're on the right track. Make sense? I just compare it to a calculator as if it's a golden standard, but what you do is you take this number, you multiply it by itself, this number, let's say, right? Multiply it by itself. And if you get a number close to 2, then you know that you're on the right track. Okay. And this is really, so here I mentioned, I'm not going to do it now, but in office, we can carry those calculations if you're interested. This will be an extra credit on the exam, I presume. And if you answer that extra credit on the exam, make sure that you answer it truly. It's your answer. Because if not, that would be one of my weapons to verify that you have not done your work on the exam. You understand? I hope you're not intending to, you will not feel pressured or worried, and you will not just copy someone else's solution or things that are not your own. Yes? So that finishes this lecture. We can talk more about it. I hope you will decide to do so. Let's move on to the next topic. Too far. When is the exam? Don't worry. Don't listen to the word exam. Listen to the word mathematics. You will not miss the exam. I promise you. It will be such an exam that you will never, ever miss. Study hard. All right. Trigonometry, lecture notes 2. Right? Remember what we spoke about, guys, right? Remember we spoke about the unit circle and the various ways of measuring angle. Do you remember what degrees are? Degrees are Babylonian slices. By the way, we are cutting the pizza where let me not bring myself into we. You, Americans, are cutting slices, a pie into 8 slices, yes? How many Babylonian slices fit in one slice? 8 slices, right? 8 American slices. How much does one American slice contain of the Babylonian slices? Thank you, Brandon. What about the rest of you? I want you to see that. I want to see that you are quickly understanding this concept. It's supposedly a review. Come on, guys, more of you, more of you. Ooh, ooh. And not because you see the solutions of somebody else, it's because you reason it, right? It's so easy, guys, right? 8 slices, what is it? It means I cut my pie into 8. So take 360 and cut it into 8 pieces, right? And what you get, it's the same as 180 cut into 4 pieces, or the same as 90 cut into 2 pieces, or 45 degrees, 45 slices. Easy? Very easy, yes? Now, we don't like degrees. We are in calculus. We are snobs. We're degree snobs now, right? Because why don't we like it? Because degrees are artificial. There is no reason to cut a pizza into 360 slices. There is nothing about it that is part of the circle, that is a unique property to the circle. On the other hand, radians, the crust, always measures 2 pi of the radius, right? That's what we do here, 2 pi of the radius. Which means what? Which means that that the crust is about 6.28 radii units length. Yes? That's a natural property, something that it's not so easy, but if you're interested, we can eventually, I'll show you how you might understand what that means. Archimedes figured that out and he was very proud of it. So it's something that everybody would understand. It's something that it's supposedly objective. So anyone would verify that if you take a radius and you fold it around the circle, you see that slightly over 6 radii will fit in. Yes. And of course, that also is something that happens when you ride in a car, right? So that's what I think, you know, this is the calculus song. I mean, the radio song. So when you're riding in the car, you're listening to the radio, your mood is great, let's say, you're riding very fast and the wheel is turning and you can see the speed. How is the speed related to the radian measure? We will listen to the full song at the end of the lecture. But what am I singing? I hear, oh, the radian. I'm a terrible singer, but you understand what I hear, right? Oh, the radian, right? That's what you should hear because the wheel is turning. And what is the length of the circumference? Let's say if the radius of the wheel is, let's say, one quarter of a meter. Or let me make a wheel. It's a very big wheel of radius one, right? Just for you to easily calculate it. How much distance do I travel each time the wheel has fully turned? One full turn of the wheel. If the radius of the wheel is one, how many meters will I have traveled? You understand my question? Your speedometer is working this way, right? So, or your odometer similarly, right? Easier than speedometer, let's talk about the odometer. You know, the odometer, right? The thing that shows you how many miles your car has driven. So let's make it in nice normal meters. If you have if you're having this monster truck wheels, right? The radius of your wheel is 1 meter. How much distance do you cover every time this wheel turns? Christian, be careful, right? You might receive a speeding ticket, right? You might think that you travel too little when you travel much more. Yes, Alan, and a few of you, you travel precisely, exactly 2 pi meters. You understand why 2 pi? Look at it, because what happens as you rotate, it's what I imagined, here is how I understood it a long time ago. I imagined a tape with very thin tape. And as you roll, the tape is unwinded and leaves the mark of the tire tread. You understand? So as the tire turns without slipping, it's like it rolls its circumference onto the ground. Yes? And so it's like a tank uncoiling its chain. Can you imagine that? And so how much do you travel with each rotation of the wheel? Radius multiplied by the circumference. You understand? Because the distance you travel is 6.28 radian lengths, which if you can convert to meters, right? What is the radius? If you have a bigger radius, you will travel bigger meters distance, right? But always the same number in radius units for your wheel. Does it make sense, guys? So that's why, for example, here is a simple question. Guys, no Christian, so let me go back there. It's a very interesting idea, very important. Okay, so can you imagine, how is it 2 pi? The circumference is 2 pi times r, right? 2 pi, not pi times r, 2 pi r. Circumference is 2 pi r. So as you roll, I have something circular here, maybe. Here, you can see this? Here, guys, you see? As I roll, it's like I uncoil the tape. And can you imagine that the tape is very thin. It doesn't reduce the radius and it's left, right? So it's like I'm unwinding the circumference. It's like imagine that's like a chain on the tank and I'm unwinding that circumference and laying it flat on the ground, right? So one turn of the wheel will correspond to 2 pi radii, right? And if one radius is 1 meter, I travel then 2 pi meters, or roughly 6.28 meters distance with every rotation. Make sense? So what would happen, guys, if you change the size of the wheel on your car? Here is a simple question. You make the size of the wheel bigger in your car, right? And then what's the effect on the odometer that it will have? You understand? You change nothing about the car. You just now replaced it by a bigger wheel, right? Let's say you replaced the wheel to be twice the size. Let's make it this way, okay? So the wheel used to be R. Now it's twice the size. You made the wheel twice as big. Yes. What will, and your odometer says that you traveled 100 miles, right? Imagine after you replaced it, the odometer says you traveled 100 miles. How much did you travel actually? You understand my question, guys? So imagine that before driving this car, you replaced the wheel to be twice the radius that it had to. You made it a monster car. Exactly, right? You traveled 200, you traveled twice as much. You understand? Because the odometer calculated how many revolutions of the wheel you did and converted it to linear distance. But that was only possible because it assumed that the radius used to be something that it's no longer equal to. Now the radius is bigger. So now every rotation actually makes you travel more. You understand? So you actually traveled 200 miles. So if you want to sell your car, here is a good thing you can do. Replace the wheel, right? Make it bigger. And then you can, and then place the original wheel back, and then your odometer is going to show a different distance, right? You can have half the distance. Sounds good? You're not impressed. Not impressed, but at least you understand the idea, correct? To survive, you have to be a scammer. All right. So now we begin with talking about trig functions. I have quite a lot of things to show you about trig functions. You watch the cartoon?
Oh.
It always reminds me of construction, okay? So what is, how do I think of trigonometric functions? So I think of a crane. And the x-axis is water. And this blob here, it's a buoy. It always stays on the water, right? And now what happens, a sine is the length of the rope, the vertical length of the rope that needs to be dropped when the crane is lifted to the buoy. And it's measured in radius units. So it's always, you're always working on a unit circle. When you say, oh, I have a unit circle, you remember what it means. All it means is that the radius of the circle is given the quantity one. You understand? There is no such thing as a unit circle. I mean, just, here is a circle, is another circle. They can be each of them unit circles if you take the different radius measurements, you see? So here I made the radius be the same. I made notches on the X and Y axis to be the length of the radius. Good? So what is sine of zero, please? Zero. Wonderful. Everybody sees it, yes? It's a review, and if it's new to you, then you still think. Now I press pause, right? Here, theta is equal to 0.73, right? 0.73. What is that? What is the 0.73 about? What's the angle here? What is the 0.73? No, not the x value. What is the 0.73? How many, but in more specifically, 0.73 means where do I look? You see, I drew the angle over here, but actually the angle is here. You understand? That means that the opening is as big to make the crust 0.73 radius units. You understand? So this arc, if I were to uncoil it and measure it against, let's say, X or Y axis, it will have length of roughly 0.73 radians. You understand where the word radians comes from? It's radius, right? And then what is the 0.67? That's just here. You can see the red line measured against the Y axis. 67% of the radius, you understand? In other words, now when I open the triangle this way, the vertical segment is 67% the length of the radius. Good? You understand what it means? So what is a sine? It's like a measurement function. You open up an angle and you measure the rope. And you measure the rope in radius units, you understand? So you standardize it. You always measure it in terms of the length of the radius, a proportion of the radius. In other words, what proportion of the radius is this? Now a question, here, what is the angle here? And of course I don't like degrees. When I move in here, what's the angle? Again, right away, 90 degrees. 90 degrees, yes, 90 slices, correct. But I want you to tell me in radians. You should abandon degrees, it's not natural. Pi over 4, right? How do you know? Pi over 2, yes, pi over 2. Pi, you see, guys, look at it. This full thing is 2 pi. half of it, that's a line, that's pi, right? The radians here, or half of a pizza pie, has a crust of length 3.14 roughly, right? 3.14 radii can be attached and make this arc, yes? Now, what is this? This is 1/4. 1/4, yes, 1/4 of the slice means, what does it mean? It means two pi divided by 4, pi over 2. Are you with me? Pi over 2. What is sine of that value? Sine of pi over 2 is what? One. You see, guys, I mean, why should you switch to degrees? You understand? What is this one? So I have two people writing one. What about the rest of you? I have about 30 students here, and that's supposedly a review. What's sine of pi over 2? Look at it. Let me help you a little bit. You see, I'm increasing, I'm making the crane vertical. And as I make it vertical, the distance to the ground is increasing. Yes, that's why this rope is getting longer. Now it's 81% of the radius. What is one? One what? One. What's the one? But this approach is one. One what? One radiant, exactly. Or one radius. You understand? Radiant, radius. It's really just a measurement in radius. Okay. And what's the biggest value, the biggest positive value that sine can take? And why? Don't write just the biggest value it can take, but write perhaps why. And you can do it, you don't need to write a paragraph. You can say it in one word. Four radians. So sine can be four radians. Four radians will be, it will be very far out. Question understood? Rachel, you look skeptical. Yes, one. It can only be as long as the radius. Beautiful, Brendan. You see, very simply, right? It just, sometimes when you go, it's, you know, longer, shorter, right? The rope can never be longer than the crane. Good? That's why sine cannot exceed the number one. You see, when I lift it up, I make the rope longest. You see that? I kind of, it's not exactly one, but I kind of got it more or less, right? One, look at it. You see the one here? One radius. Are you with me? And then as I move, this is called first quadrant. This is second quadrant, third and fourth. You see, I rotate counterclockwise, yes? So then afterwards, the crane is now going towards the ground. You see, I drew this small circle here, but there is nothing. Why do you draw a small circle? It's just because people don't like to draw a big circle. That's where you see the angle, actually. The angle is here. You understand? The crust is representing the angle. Now, what happens to sine in the second quadrant? It decreases. Do you see that? It decreases. When is it going to be zero again? Exactly. Simply pi, right? The reason I say 3.14 is for you to have a better feel of it, right? It's an irrational number. At pi, it will be zero. Here. I almost got it, right? 3.1, it needs to go a little bit more and it will be zero. 3.4, right? It will be exactly zero. Good, 3.14. Good. What happens as I go into quadrant three? What happens to sine, do you think? Now the crane is underwater. See that? So all you do is you just communicate that the crane is underwater by measuring the rope against the negative y-axis. You see, you not only specify length, but you also specify with a sign whether the crane is underwater. Good? So here it's negative, and look at it. This is pi over 2, 2 pi over 2, this will be 3π/2, right? When I move 3/4 of a circle, 3π/2. Yes? 3π/2 will be what? The sine will reach its lowest value, -1. You see that? And then it's periodic. Good? Then it's periodic. You understand? If I rotate again, it's now, it's 2π plus an angle, etc., right? So that I indicate how many rotations. So then, of course, it repeats itself. That's essentially all you have to know about sine. Now, cosine is the shadow, this green shadow, yes? What's cosine of zero? Cosine of zero is 1. Because if the crane lies on the x-axis, look at it, by the way. Of course, if you turn it around, you can make the x-axis vertical. You see that sine and cosine are essentially the same function. Do you see that? Because the shape is symmetric. Make this the vertical and it will look to you like sine. Yes? Cosine and sine are very much the same functions, right? The very, very slight difference. It just, you measure this horizontal thing. It's a matter of perspective, of course, right? That's pretty useful when you can recognize those properties. But this is just measured as we are looking at it here. This is cosine. It's right now a little bit, it's about 0.7 or 0.8, something like this, right? It's here, you see? I have another video for cosine if you want it. Make sense? So when is cosine going to be zero? That's pretty clear as well. Cosine is at most 1, at most the length of the crane, and at least -1, and it will be zero when the crane is vertical, because then there is no green shadow, yes? When crane is vertical, either vertical up or vertical underwater, that's when, that's when cosine is zero, good? Are you with me, guys? Here, by the way, is a very popular video, and I'm pretty sure I know why it's popular. So, is it better, Alan? No, it's not better. No, the other one is also pop. All of them are, yes. But I like the other music, actually. Yeah, on the radio, I do like, even though it's pop. So here, guys, how is this constructed? I can show you another video that is slightly less less cool, but in my opinion, more informative, right? I made those, this is another video I made. The music my brother selected both songs. In my opinion, of course, Chopin is not the music for sine, but the drawing here is a bit, in my opinion, slightly better. Do you understand what it is? How is the graph of sine generated? Do you understand what you do? You uncoil the angle. Do you see that? You see, what is this dotted line? This dotted line is this dark blue curve uncoiled and laid flat on the x-axis. And this is the corresponding y-length. So for each uncoiling, for each point, I just open it up and I measure the, I take this piece of rope and I place it there. You understand? Make sense? You understand what we look at it? This segment and that segment are exactly of the same length. You are with me? And this blue curve and that dashed blue curve are exactly of the same length, uncoiled, right? And here is how the graph is generated. Make sense? Just how much of the circle have I traveled and what piece is there? Good? Very simple. What do you mean, Dante, uneven lengths? What do you mean by that? Sounds interesting, but I'm not, you mean that this length and that length are not the same? Yeah, sure, because that's how we generate. You understand? So sine function is this Carpenter function. You understand? You're just making, you do not know what are the values right now, but you can generate this function without knowing those values. You just, what you do is you make a bunch of measurements. They create this device, open up an angle, measure the arc, lay it flat on the x-axis, and take that stick of rope, stretch it from that tip of the unfolded arc, and here is your segment. And you do that everywhere here, you understand? You do that everywhere here. Over on the previous, thing, I made it dance. The fact that it moves, it's not necessary, you understand? I just made the circle move. And guess how did I make it move, guys? I used calculus 3, which you're of course are going to take, right? When you can describe motions, right? I mean, this is actually what you see moving. It's actually a two-dimensional shape. One of the dimensions is projected to you sequentially, and that is time. So I describe something that where the other parameter is time. You could have made a surface out of it. All right. I hope you find it interesting. Here is another important function. So the most important functions to know, I would say sine, cosine, and tangent. Then the next one in importance is secant. You see, sine, cosine, tangent, then secant, and then you have the remaining two trigonometric functions you want to know, but they are kind of somewhat in the back. You know, I see them less frequently, so to speak, right? I see them, yeah, I want to know them, but specifically sine, cosine, tangent, and then secant. Okay, here is one thing to say about tangent, guys. Look at the drawing. You see, here is that green segment, it's cosine. Here is the red segment, it's sine. Here is my angle, it's actually here. And here is tangent. Look at it. Do you understand why is that tangent? Tangent is defined as opposite over adjacent. Red over green in this case, yes? Red over green. Look at it, by the way. It's rise over run. So tangent describes slope of this line, yes? And remember that slope is proportional. If I extend this radius further out, I can extend this green line anywhere I like, and I can then extend the red line anywhere I like. I can either make it smaller. I can, for example, do this, right? I can decide to measure it like this. Yes? So we have this triangle, or I can make the bigger triangle, the one you see here with the tangent. Those triangles are all proportional. You understand what proportionality is, guys? Think about it. Here is a finger. And here is my nose. For simplicity, let's say that my finger, my index finger and the nose are of the same length. Yes? That means that if you make a statue of me, smaller or larger, you see, one reason to make a statue of me is that then you can actually break it and destroy it like it's common to do these days. You know, you break statues. So, but first you have to build one. So here is my nose and my finger. If I scale, if I want to make a big model of it, the finger of the big model to the nose of the big model will have the same proportion. You understand? So similar thing is happening here with the triangle. Good? Is that this length divided by the adjacent must be the same as red over green. And then I can use a convenient length for the horizontal. I can make it equal to 1. You understand? At the tip of the circle, the length, the horizontal length is 1. You understand? And then whatever is the vertical length happens to be tangent. Have you understood the explanation why the tangent is as I drew it here? Yes, or are you playing poker? Rachel, poker? No or yes? You see, this length can be 1, and this altitude is then whatever the altitude divided by 1 is the same as red over green. That's why I make it here. I make this, I stretch the horizontal to be equal to 1, because then I don't need to do anything in terms of division, right? And this is now tangent. Now you see that when you convert to degrees, you're actually changing measurements. Why do you need to change measurements? Angle can be measured in radians, and the sine and cosine are producing radian measures, you understand? Sine is a radian measure. So when you press in the calculator sine of 45 degrees, the number that you're getting is how much of a radius. You're getting radian measure. It is good to measure both angle and can measure length. Good, so you get used to it, and you will see that when we're going to do derivatives, the results of with sine and cosine measured, if you measure the angle in degrees, the results are not as nice, they are clumsier. If you measure everything in radians, then the results are very nice. So this is my tangent. Help me figure out a few things about tangent, guys. Tangent of zero is what? You can see it from this picture. Tangent of zero. That means we open the angle to zero, and what do we get? Zero, right? Why? Because vertical segment is zero, horizontal is one. Tangent of zero is zero over one. It's also a horizontal line. Notice, rise over run. Tangent measures slope. You agree? Slope of that line. Now, what happens to tangent as I increase the angle? Look at it. I increase the angle. I increase the angle. What do you think happens to tangent? Pretty simple, right? Increase the angle. What happens to tangent? Tangent is slope. First of all, in the first quadrant, tangent is positive because the line is pointing up. Yes? Increase it, increase it, increase it. What is that approaching to? Slope is getting bigger. Approaching what value? Slope approaches 1. This line at 45 degrees will be 1. Yes, but as I rotate it more, the line gets to be more and more vertical. Rise over run. Cosine is approaching 0. Sine approaches 1. 0 plus, right? This is over the positive x-axis. So we are getting slope equal to... to what? To infinity. Thank you, Jim. You all understand, guys? You see, play it in your mind. When it's playing a video in your mind, it's ever so slightly more exciting. So as I increase my angle, you see where the red dot is going. As I push the red dot towards pi over 2. That's pi over 2 from the left. Left because it's less than pi over 2, right? Pi over 2 and slightly less than that. The slope approaches infinity. What about if I go in here? What is tangent in this quadrant? Positive or negative? First of all, in this quadrant, tangent is positive or negative? All right, so some of you are confused. Look at it, guys. Ask yourself a few simple questions. What is this? Is this slope, this line? I can draw it farther, right? This line, does it have positive or negative slope? You always measure it by looking, by moving to the right and seeing if you are falling down or climbing, right? So this has a negative slope, yes? You agree? Negative slope. We can also see what is the shadow. The shadow here, well, we have, this is my sine, it's positive. And the shadow is my cosine, it's negative. Yes, because it's measured on the negative x-axis. Positive over negative is negative, right? So what do I have? I have that that tangent of theta. In this case, that's theta. Yeah? That's my theta, tangent of theta when I reach the second quadrant is less than zero, yes? And as I approach this position, look at it. As I approach this position, let's say I am in here, right? Close to zero. Yeah. Then what am I observing? I'm observing a very small, but negative displacement on the x-axis. Yes, this is my sine, which is positive and almost one, and my cosine is small, right? So as I increase, as a very steep negative slope, exactly, right? So the point is that limit as theta goes to pi over two plus, right? Plus means I'm slightly more than pi over two, right? Bigger than pi over two of tangent theta, that is going to be minus infinity. Everybody sees that? It's minus infinity. Can I draw the tangent on this side? Sure, I will try. You're testing my ability to use my stylus. Okay. The tangent on this side, look, it's actually going to be huge. Okay, so here is what the tangent going to look like. I mean, the actual segment, right? So what you do is you draw a vertical line. It goes on and on, right? It's huge. You see why? And then you see where the black line would have met it. Understand? I actually made it broken because it's way outside of the screen. It's huge. You understand why that is a similar triangle? I just decided to make this of length one. That creates the tangent picture. Does it make sense, Rachel? Does it make sense, everyone else, guys? Right? I do hope that you are understanding it, right? I'm explaining it. I think I'm such a nice person. I'm explaining trigonometry, spending time again, which it's supposed to be a prerequisite, right? I do that because I want you to know it strongly, not just memorize some stuff, right? I want you to understand. And if anything is not understood, I easily forgive it. You can ask me a million times, but if you don't care to understand, that upsets me very much. Yes, pi over two is the top point on the circle, yes? And you can then play around with trig, or after class we can play around if you want to review it, okay? So let's look at some basic property. Why would it not be positive infinity where? So if you are here, when the line is vertical, it's not clear, is it positive vertical or negative vertical? When it's vertical, it's hard to tell whether it's going down or up, you understand? If you move a vertical line, if you lean it slightly like this, that means a negative slope. If you lean it slightly like that, that's a positive slope. Does it make sense? You know how you think about it. You see, imagine that you're driving. Here is a stick that's standing almost straight, right? If you are driving to the, you're always driving to the right. If you're driving to the right, do you see that this thing is increasing in size? So in other words, if you were to walk to the right, will you be climbing, right? If it's like this, if you're walking to the right, you are descending. That's why it's negative, you see? So if it's exactly vertical, slightly to the left, it's negative, slightly to the right, it's positive. Good. Brilliant. So it is a mortal sin to say that sine of theta is sinus or a sin times theta. You understand? It is just that I get explosively enraged when I see that, especially when I explained, right? This is not an algebraic operation. This just is a name, you understand? Sine of theta is just the same name as root of two. Or you can say it Arkady of theta. Here's a black box. Plug into the black box theta and something will be done to that theta to produce the corresponding ratio, the corresponding fraction. Okay, so make sure not to make this mistake. Okay, or at least think about it. Okay, truly think about it. Okay. Here are some questions to consider. Of course, remember what we did to e to the x. Can you still produce the value of e like I taught you? Remember I wrote the polynomial expansion for e to the x. Yes. When I imagined what it should be, I was able to come up with a formula that calculates. So a similar thing that you want to ask yourself, can you do that for sine and cosine? You understand? Can you figure out how is this, what is happening to the angle? How is the angle transformed into the ratio? What formula? Could it be a polynomial formula? So that's something that we will consider as we go on. When you know about sine slightly more, we will be able to try to talk about it, okay? There are deep, deep connections. If you're, for example, if you're interested in that book that I mentioned, quantum physics, guess what is gonna be important? Calculus, and within calculus, probability, and trigonometry and exponential functions are immediately at play. That's not coincidental, it's just obvious, okay? And there is a link between trigonometry and exponential. So here are a few basic properties, very basic properties about trig. So you see, if you are going to plug in negative angle, that means you're opening the angle from zero clockwise. You understand? So for example, negative one, sine of negative one means that my I'm opening up what? Negative one means I'm opening up a slice that has crust of length radius. And I'm doing it clockwise, you understand? So sine of minus one would have been some sort of construction in this quadrant, in the fourth quadrant. You know, it's one, two, three, four. You move counterclockwise when you consider quadrants, yes? As opposed to positive sense of the angle means you go counterclockwise, okay? Negative angle means you rotate clockwise. Positive angle means you rotate counterclockwise. And notice this relationship, sine of negative theta is minus sine of theta. Do you see why? Here is theta, here is minus theta. The triangles produced are the same in shape, except here the rope is above water, here it's below water. You see, this is sine of theta, this is minus sine of theta. Make sense? Could you tell me, help me please, tell me what's cosine of, here is my next question. Could you please tell me what's the relationship between cosine of minus theta and cosine theta? What's the relationship between them? Same. It is equal. Exactly equal. Do you understand why? Here, look at this picture. Open the angle clockwise or counterclockwise, you get the same shadow. You see, you can play around. You can make the angle bigger or smaller. Symmetric angle theta or minus theta, it means symmetry around the x-axis. Yes? So that means that we have the same horizontal shadow, whether on positive x-axis or negative, doesn't matter. If I make this theta bigger, the shadow will be here. And then minus theta, the shadow would also be here. Good? So you can see that cosine of minus theta equals to cosine of theta. What about if I replace this by tangent? What is it now? Different signs, opposite. So in particular, I can write minus here. Yes. Good. Oh, hello, Fu. Nice to see you. So it's a minus here. Why is it a minus? Because it's sine over cosine. Sine changes its value to minus. Sine of minus theta is minus sine theta. Cosine does not change its value. So good. Yes, okay, great. So let's move on. So the x and y coordinates can be related like I show in this picture. Okay, so what I want to know is if I open up an angle and this circle is, I don't consider it a unit circle because the measurements on the x and y axis are not matching the length of the radius. It's not one radius, right? I have different notches, right? Then when I want to know what is x? So maybe let's just for a moment put numbers here, guys. Imagine that this number here, it's minus 5. And this number here, it's 5, right? And this x measures 4 units. It's 4, right? What is cosine? Cosine of this angle theta. Without knowing the theta, just you know this information. What's based on this picture? This is minus 4, right? So what is cosine of this theta equal to, given this information? No, not 8 pi. You understand what I did? I placed the markers 5 and minus 5, and let's say the x is minus 4. I want to know, and this theta, I don't know what it is. I'm asking, what does x measure? Minus 4 over 5. It measures minus 4 divided by 5. What is that quantity? Would anybody help me understand it? What is that minus 4 over 5? No, it wouldn't cancel. Because I'm not dividing minus 4 by minus 5. What am I trying to ask? When I ask for cosine of theta, what's the gist of my question? Let me remind you. The gist of my question is to ask, how long is x in terms of unit radius? How long is x in radius length? Does it make sense? So when I say cosine of theta and I see this segment, I'm asking how long is it in terms of radius. Now I know that the circle has radius equal to 5 units, right? So to convert x to radii, I just divide it by the size of the radius by one. This 5 is the value of one radius. You understand? I see how many times does one radius go into here. And that's minus 4 over 5, which will be minus 0.8 radian. You understand? I just convert. It's all a matter of converting measurements. That's why cosine is defined to be adjacent over hypotenuse, because hypotenuse may be specified in another unit, right? And when you do adjacent over hypotenuse, you convert the measurement to radians. Does it make sense? Confirm if you understood what I just said. I hope what I'm saying is actually making things clear and easy. So in general, look at it, guys. In general, if I know that the radius is of length r, where r is any number. In other words, maybe I measure it r centimeters long or r inches long or whatever this r is, right? I'm not measuring into, if the radius is given any number other than 1, it means I'm not measuring in terms of radius units, right? I'm not measuring in radius units. So then I see that x divided by r will be cosine of theta, will be this length in radius units. And that implies that x equal to r cosine. You know, I just multiply by r. X is equal to r cosine theta. And y equal to r sine theta. Similarly, I measure y in terms of radian units, so I just need to divide it by r. Good? Make sense? So it's r sine theta. So this point has coordinates r cosine theta, r sine theta. And this is, of course, something I use all the time. So in the animations that you've seen, I use that. It's a translation between polar coordinates and the rectangular coordinates. Okay? So if I know x and y, I can figure out the cosine and sine. Or if I know the theta, if I know the length of the arc, I can figure out the corresponding sides of the right triangle. Good. Now, here is something that we know from Pythagoras' theorem. Cosine squared plus sine squared is 1. That's really, understand what's cosine. Cosine squared means the horizontal side squared plus vertical side squared will be equal to the 1 radius squared. Understand what it means? That is clear. Yes, guys? Cosine squared plus sine squared is 1. All you're saying is that horizontal side squared plus vertical side squared equal to the remaining, to the hypotenuse squared. You just change the measurement in different units. If you change it in different units, you still find this property. You understand what I mean? So a lot of things are immediately obvious if you understand what are those things communicating, right? So you translate from one measurement to another. This is just saying, one side squared plus the vertical side squared equal to the hypotenuse squared. Good. And now if I divide everything by cosine squared, I get 1 plus tangent squared, 1 over cosine squared is secant, right? 1 divided by cosine is secant. So in other words, when you take hypotenuse and divide by adjacent or 1 over cosine, that gives you secant. And I can do a similar thing by dividing by sine, and I get cotangent squared plus 1 equal to cosecant squared. So make sure that you understand it. Just once I know this formula, cosine squared plus sine squared equal to 1, and I understand why that's true. Just Pythagorean theorem stated differently. I realize that 1 plus tangent squared equal to secant squared, and cotangent squared plus 1 equal to cosecant squared. Now, here is the problem. Most trig functions are kind of difficult to calculate. If I give you an arbitrary angle without carrying out measurements, it will be difficult for you to find it out. If you have a ruler, you can do it, you see? If I have a ruler, all I have to do is measure the length of the radius, measure the length of x, and divide x by the length of the radius, right? And what is the angle? I just measure how long it is, right? The arc is of length r times theta, because this is how it much it measures in the units on the x and y axis, r times theta, right? Theta is just, it's the measurement of this arc when I just use radius as my measurement unit. It's all measurement, very simple, good? So here are some very, very obvious trig identities, right? So let's consider why do you know sine of 45 degrees precisely, or sine of pi over 4? By the way, sine of pi over 4, how many, remind me guys, how many slices do you have in an American pizza? Eight, right? And pi over 4 is 1/8 of 2 pi, right? So this means pi over 4, this is asking this. If I take an American slice, this is an American slice, and then the arc is going to be pi over 4 radians, right? For an American slice, the radius can be placed pi over 4 times here, right? And then I'm asking sine of that. I'm then asking pretty much what's the length of this line. Yes. What's the length of this line in terms of radius units? Good. So here is how I can easily, so in school when I was doing that, I figured out that it's not hard to understand it, and I figured out those procedures. You don't refer to any table, what table for, right? You reason it out and you don't need any table. What you do is this, right? So you take a square of sides one and one. It's a square of side one. Now, what's the angle of that square? It's pi over 2 radians, or 90 degrees. And if I cut it in half, it's pi over 4. You agree? Take a square, cut it in half, pi over 4. What is the remaining angle? Pi over 4. Remember, I taught you that the angles add up to pi. Pi over 2 plus pi over 4 plus pi over 4, right? This has to be pi over 4. That means, and this is pi over 2. The remaining one must also be pi over 4. Oh, you just see that because you slice those angles in half. Yes? Now, this is of length 1. This is of length 1. What's the length of the hypotenuse? It's 1 squared plus 1 squared square root. It's square root of 2. You're with me? So what is sine of pi over 4? It's 1 divided by square root of 2. It's opposite divided by hypotenuse. 1 over root 2. Which, if I like, I can multiply numerator and denominator by root 2. So it's root 2 over 2. Yes? Now I have the information within this triangle. I can see all my important trig functions, yes? So for example, what's tangent of pi over 4? It's opposite over adjacent, it's 1, right? Tangent of pi over 4 is 1. What is cotangent of pi over 4, please? So calculate cosine, tangent, secant, cosecant, cotangent of pi over 4, please. And send me the solutions, preferably all at once. So of course, guys, I should mention Sokatoha. I hate such mnemonics. So just I don't understand why it helps. Just I call it understanding, right? But what the hell is Sokatoha? Understand. Good, James. So you understand how I produce this square, right? You could figure it on your own. In the table, it's way too big for what it does. So cosine is adjacent over square root of 2. So it's the same, yes? What about secant? Secant is hypotenuse over adjacent, so it's root 2, right? Cosecant, it's hypotenuse over opposite, also root 2, okay? Very easy. Now, could you help me with this, guys? What is 3 pi over 4? The 6 trigonometric functions at 3 pi over 4. Can you help me with that? Wait, that'll be I asked for 3π/4, right? To figure out all the 6 trig functions. So what you can do is you can draw yourself a circle. And then ask yourself, where do we have 3π/4? What is 3π/4? It's 3 American slices. You agree? 3 American slices is roughly what I eat whenever I order slices. But I can eat an entire pie. So here it's π/4. 1π/4, 2π/4, 3π/4. Yes? That means I'm in the second quadrant. Easy, right? Then I drop the red line. I can also think of 3π/4 as beginning with pi. It's also pi minus π/4. Yes? In other words, go all the way to half a pi and then remove, just rotate clockwise back. You overshot and rotate back. So it means essentially that this angle is π/4, but in the second quadrant. Now all you have to remember is what? Now you just complete this information, guys, right? What is this length? This length it has to be normalized. So this would be 1/√2 with a negative. This length here will be 1/√2. If you prefer, you can multiply top and bottom by √2, and then it reads as something else. Make sense? You understand how I got those values, right? I showed you before, I did 1 and 1, and √2 is the hypotenuse. So if I normalize hypotenuse to be √2, I just divide everything by √2. You see what I'm saying? So remember, this is all you have to understand. If this is 1 and this is 1, then this is π/4. This is π/2. This is π/4. This was √2. So that means that if this is my radius, that means a similar triangle would be where this is 1. Then this was, if to produce 1, I had to divide hypotenuse by √2. So then I have to divide every other side by √2. So it's 1/√2 here. And 1/√2 here. Okay, that's my triangle from which I can easily read the information, right? So then once I know this is negative, this is positive, everything else is very simple, right? So cosine of this angle would be -1/√2. Sine will be 1/√2, yes? Tangent will be -1. You can see the slope is negative, right? It's this number to that number. Okay, guys, if you are not, I'm rushing a little bit. That means that if you are not understanding anything, you do stay after class to discuss this material. Good? Agreed? So because don't let it slide. Trigonometry is extremely important for this course. Most people, even after all this effort, they just do not understand it or just forget about it. And if you get trigonometry, you get this level of abstraction. It's a very enjoyable and simple class. And I see I lost another few people. 26. My God.
Professor, I have a question.
Yes.
So when we do have a test of some kind, well, our first test, are you going to give us like a practice test?
No.
Or something?
No. There are plenty of practice tests you can see on my website.
Okay. So
yes, it's actually, the test is going to be very, I will see how it happens. I have a feeling that once people see the test, they might feel they don't need to be in this class because, I make passing rather easy, right? But then if I see that happening, of course, I'll get upset and then I'll begin teaching you Russian or Prichnin. I'll teach you what it means to get me paranoid.
That would help with my Russian class then.
Say it again?
That would help with my Russian class, so I have no complaints.
Good. I that's very good. Thank you. It will help with your Russian. You're learning Russian, huh? That's great. I don't know. Polish is similar to Russian, though. I mean, you say it's yes. I actually also figured to learn Polish, but we'll see if I'll do it. Too many things to pick up. I know a few things, of course, right? So another triangle, guys. Well, so you see, then you have 3π/4, 5π/4. We can practice with those angles in office hours. Another thing is, here is the other triangle. You only have two triangles for which it's very easy to, it's very easy to find the actual exact trig values for only a few things, right? In all your school years, there are only two things. If you take a triangle that is equilateral, you can fold it and you can see that the angles here are the same. Fold it differently here. You say fold it like this. So this angle and that angle must be the same. Similarly, this angle has to be the same. Just fold it. I didn't draw a perfect equilateral triangle, but if I did, you could have drawn the line right through from this corner to this corner, and that would have bisected this side in half. Yes? And then you would have matched this angle to that angle. So all the angles are the same, and the sum is pi. Which means that each angle is π/3. You understand why I know the angle is π/3? Just simple geometry. I can fold it, and I see that this angle is the same as the other one. And the top angle is the same as the remaining two. So that means that, simple equation, yes, guys? It means that 3 times that angle equals to pi. So the angle equals to π/3. Yes, that we understand that. And then I cut this triangle in half, as in here, I cut it in half. And then I cut the top angle, it's now π/6. This is now π/2, 90 degrees. And then this used to be 1, so it's now length 1/2. And then I'm figuring out what's the remaining side. What is this altitude? It's 1 squared minus 1/2 squared. And take the square root of that, so it's square root of 3/2. So this length is square root of 3/2. So for example, cosine of π/3 is simply 1/2. Sine of π/3 is √3/2. I just see this side. You see, it's already in normal, this is one radius, one, right? So it's one radius. So sine of π/3 is √3/2. Now, if I want to know what sine of π/6, it's just, this is the opposite. You see, then I look at the triangle on the side, I just look this way. So the opposite to π/6 is 1/2. So sine of π/6 is 1/2. And et cetera, you understand? This way you can figure out the angles. So there is no reason to, and here is a bunch of practice, you see? You need to compute all 6 trig functions at all those numbers, sine of 2π/3, we can play around with it. There is never any need to memorize anything beyond the definition of sine. And then, of course, we are up to a very important and last property that we have to in order to find the derivative. Of course, you see some people that don't understand. The next question we need to figure out is, what is cosine of the difference of two angles? Cosine of beta minus alpha. Right? And a lot of people do right away, well, it's cosine of beta minus cosine of alpha. And that's, of course, absolutely incorrect. Yes, it doesn't work like this. It's not cosine distributed to beta and cosine distributed to alpha. It's not multiplication, you understand? I'm not sure what people think, or maybe they don't think at all about it, but you don't distribute cosine in here and in here. And when people do that, after my explanation, it gets me very upset, as you know, I figure they just don't care. It's like my efforts were in vain. So you can easily see that that's not the case with a little thought, because cosine of 0 minus 0 is cosine of 0, which is 1. But cosine of 0 minus cosine of 0 is 0. It could not possibly be true. You could verify with very simple examples. You just investigate it scientifically. I do not think I will continue describing this property because I'm running out of time. I just have 1 minute here, and it will take me at least, I think, 10 minutes to explain it, maybe longer. But if you're interested, read it ahead of time. I do want to move faster. There is so much to consider, so much to cover. It's always at the expense of something else. Yes, I would have just said read it and then do it in office hours. I just do not know if you will. All right, so I part with you by listening to that full song. Stay with me if you want to do office hours. How many O's remind you of the circle, right? Don't forget. Great. So